The idea of actually influencing human missions to Mars in our near future is super exciting. And what's awesome is that this team is marching forward on that path towards sending humans to Mars. That's our objective. BASALT is the evolution of many other projects that have come before it. Many of us have been involved with NASA analog projects for over a decade now, and what they are projects where you simulate a certain environment, and so Craters of the Moon is meant to be an analog or a comparison to present-day Mars. Craters of the Moon is full of basalt, a very interesting volcanic rock for our purposes, because there are similar rocks on Mars, and so we're going to take the knowledge we learned here, understand the landscape that we're looking at in terms of the Earth landscape, and then try to generate some hypotheses, some ideas, scientific ideas about what we could expect on Mars.
The activities are all centered around these missions, and so mission day one, mission day two, mission day three. Each mission day we have a series of extravehicular activities.
They're doing an in-sim EVA, which means this is a simulated other world, and we don't know what we need, right? So all of these tests is to go and simulate something that's never been done before.
Our mission objective today was to find unaltered basalt in highway flow, which we've nicknamed Mordor, because it is incredibly rough terrain. So we need to go to these different locations. We put down sample tags. We describe why we think this is a good candidate for an unaltered piece of the rock. As we're doing this, it's feeding more information to the science team on Earth. They're giving us feedback, and they finally gave us the go-ahead to sample some rocks. We brought them back samples for the geology, biology, organic geochemistry teams, as well as an archive.
I'm really here to help the basalt team and to help the finesse team do what they're trying to do. Our team has been operating two vehicles on the surface of Mars for 12 and a half years now. We've gained a lot of experience in conducting scientific operations on the Martian surface, and this is all about simulating conduct of science operations on the Martian surface. And you've got all the issues of how to deal with time delays. You know, it might take 10, 15 minutes for a radio signal traveling at the speed of light to travel from Earth to Mars, and then something happens on Mars, and another 10 or 15 minutes for it to come back.
It's really rough trying to be a partner in a conversational exchange in which you have, like today, 15 minute one-way travel on messages. So I say something now, 15 minutes later it gets to Earth, and then I've got another 15 minute wait, assuming they answer instantly. So we have to be very cognizant of time. We have to make sure that we're giving the best information we can on the first pass, and that we don't rush through any of our stages, because we're actually then taking away from the science team on Earth the ability to process that data, understand it, and come to educated decisions to help guide us.
We've tried a 5-minute latency and also a 15-minute latency. And we've got, you know, this awesome mobile mission control center back here, but with that latency, we're having to realize how little control mission control actually has. And I think that will make a big impact as we plan for going to a place like Mars.
Imagine doing all the things that we did out there today, but doing it in a spacesuit. So that's the thing, kind of area that where my focus is on humans when they go to Mars, what systems they will need. Everything from communication systems to spacesuits to life support systems, rovers that might support them getting into the field.
One of the things that rovers do for you is they allow you to understand the environment pretty well before you incur the cost and the risk. So when humans then go into the environment, all the easy questions have been answered.
So when I'm out there, I'm constantly thinking about, this is the terrain that we're going to have to put astronauts in the future. How do I need to provide the requirements and the performance for the systems of the future?
What really surprised me was how complicated it is. I mean, it's complicated to do it on Earth. I mean, to think about having to do it on a real mission to Mars, it's just, the complications are phenomenal. I think it's an amazing feat that we can actually set up this simulation and get it to work.
Getting the technology to work in an environment like this is amazingly hard, and so the difference between a good comms day and a bad comms day makes all the difference. There's not a lot of Bluetooth out here, so being able to connect them to the communication capabilities of the backpacks, they go from there to there, up to there and over to there, so being able to have that sort of relay capability so that the signals can go from the tablets in the backpack to the big wide world.
we've brought all these people together, and what's amazing and really cool to me is that they don't operate as sort of separate entities working in parallel, but everybody has to get intermingled and intertwined and share their ideas and their perspectives on how to do a human scientific mission on Mars.
If you try and do just a science task, we can understand a lot about what we'd be looking for up there, but we have no idea how to relate that back to how we could actually enact it. And similarly, if we just concentrate on the exploration side, but we never center that around what are the science needs that we'd be chasing while we're there, we design what might be an extraordinarily successful mission, but doesn't bring back the data that we wanted for the science. So if we're going to be really successful when we get there, we have to start marrying these things now to make sure that our science is informed by exploration and our exploration is informed by science, and both can grow together.
I can tell you that this is an absolute dream come true. I grew up in a small town. It was larger than ARCO, but it wasn't too big. And to be able to be part of a project like this, where we have individuals who are so dedicated, who are so committed, so intelligent and innovative, and to be part of that day in and day out, and just see that everyone is so passionate about this idea of getting humans to Mars, is totally a dream come true.